you know, even before you get completely smashed. Like, it always
I would know nothing about
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I've heard. Rumor has it.
Karl Cook may be able to walk around his home city unrecognized.
You know, getting my feet wet on what it's going to be like, you know.
He doesn't compete in a league with the popularity of the NFL. His sport doesn't market their mega stars with the likes of Tiger Woods, Shohei Ohtani, or LeBron James. But on a ranch here in San Diego, he has been training relentlessly, perfecting his craft. Equestrian jumping. And now, Karl Cook has returned home with some serious hardware.
In your wildest dreams, did you ever think you would be an Olympic medalist?
I mean, you dream about it for a lot of years. You know, I've been actively training for probably 25, 26 years, and that's always been the goal for us. And so it's just, you know, been a long road to get here, and it's an amazing feeling.
And that amazing feeling almost didn't take place. Karl's path to earn a silver medal in this year's Paris Games came in a resilient way.
You guys went through a lot to see if you were even going to be on the Olympic team, and then you did get selected as an alternate. What were the emotions when you got selected? Was it, man, I would have loved to have been one of those three? Was it, hey, a million people would be in my shoes right now, would love it?
I mean, no, I was pissed. I mean, I'm a competitor. You know, I felt I did enough to make it. They put me as alternate. So sure, I was pissed, but at the same time, I was still going. So I had to take advantage of that opportunity, and I was really happy we did.
Originally selected as an alternate, it was quite possible, even likely, that Cook would be watching on the sidelines in Versailles while his three American teammates competed for gold.
People were like, oh, what was that like? It must have been wild. And I was like, well, you know, my job as alternate was to be ready to compete. That was the whole why they put me on the team. And so if I was going to go be the alternate, I was going to be the best alternate I could be.
And that is exactly what he was. A late change just hours before team qualification had Cook on the back of his horse, Caracol de la Roque, ready to ride for the United States.
Get 2.5 hours. Is it nerves, or do you think that short of time was a good thing and that it was like, hey, it's go time, we don't even have time to get nervous?
Sure, there's always nerves. I think if you don't have nerves, you ride worse. No, you can't have like overpowering nerves, you just freeze. But you know, nerves are a good thing, and you know, I was just excited to show and you know, trying to focus on getting the job done.
All clear, as they say. The job was indeed done. Caracol and Karl had two perfect rounds to help the United States take home the silver.
When you look back on the entire buildup to the Olympics, in the week of the Olympics, and really the whirlwind that it all was, what do you take away from it?
It's really intense. Like, it's really stressful. You know, you wonder, second guess, doubt yourself of, was that enough? Did you need to do more? Were you good enough? Are you as a person good enough? Like, it's not as just like, oh, I did great, I'm on the team, and let's go. Yeah. You know, there's a lot of emotions that you have to deal with when you're not used to it and you haven't been through it before. You don't know what to expect or what to feel or how to deal with it. So it's a challenge.
At one point you had to pinch yourself. You're like on the Seine River, on a boat, LeBron James is up there like George Washington. There's a great picture of you kind of in the crowd there. Like, I mean, you had to just go like, I'm here.
Yeah, I mean, that was fun. Look, you know, if I was gonna go to the Olympics, I was gonna do opening ceremony. You know, sure, it was a bit of a bummer. It rained literally the whole time. It was still just, you had to do it. It was so cool having all the athletes there, you know, from the US, having the other athletes, we were cheering boat to boat. You know, you started to understand what, you know, why this is, you know, as special as it is.
Cook would not only help the Americans get on the podium in the team event, but he would also get called into action for the individual round, where once again he qualified for the medal round after another perfect showing.
You know, my horse was, she was gonna jump clear. She was feeling, you know, unbelievable on course. You know, it's a feeling, it's hard to explain, but like I just knew that we were there.
But competing against the best riders in the world on an Olympic stage, there is zero room for error.
The rails were my fault. And I just felt like I let her down. And yeah, that's that's hard, because it's so hard to get to that place in a career, and then to know that if you just don't mess it up, you're gonna jump clear, and then to mess up like that, that's hard.
Cook would clip two rails in his final round, missing out on an individual medal.
You know, I'm still proud because outside of that mistake, you know, we had a nearly perfect week. And it's so hard at that level to do that. You know, disappointed we didn't have that final, you know, that final cherry, but the fact we got a show was great. The big thing, you know, I made a mistake the last day, but, you know, all of our preparation work, all of our feelings going in, our intuitions, the actions that we took based off our intuitions were right. Or right in the sense that they led us to the position where I would argue she was the best horse that day.
And while the Paris Games have just wrapped up, it's hard, especially as a San Diego resident, for Karl not to turn his attention to the next Summer Olympics in Los Angeles.
Now that you have a taste of that Olympic touch, 2028, has it come to your mind yet right here in the backyard? I know it's far away, but I imagine you've already started to think about it?
Oh, of course, of course. You know, I'm excited to show it home. You know, we're sitting at the farm here in San Diego, and we're gonna be, you know, an hour or two away. It's hard to have an Olympics closer to home. Could be, you know, in New York, and that'd technically be home because it's the US, but this is like home, like actually home.
And when those Olympics take place right up the road in LA, Cook will be one of the very rare riders from Southern California. One of the many things that makes Karl unique to the show jumping world.
What do you feel your perception is in this sport to the outsiders looking in? And then on top of that, because of that perception, how vindicating was this past week in change?
Oh, I don't know how people see me. You know, I think in some ways I'm the loud guy from the West Coast in a very traditional sport. And some people find that a bit off-putting, but you know, I try to back up everything with results in the ring, and I don't need you to like me. You know, I hope I can show that the way I treat my horses, the way I work with my horses, you can't deny that we're doing the best job.
And the way you treat Blueberry, right?
And Blueberry, of course.
But it's of course not just Blueberry that gets all the love at Pomponio Ranch.
What is the connection you have with these animals?
Yeah, I mean they're a lot like family, and they're a lot like friends. You know, the amount of time we spend with them is honestly more than most people spend with their best friend. Like one of your best friends you've known since, you know, elementary school, you know when they're feeling wrong. You know when they got an itch, you know when something's a little bit off. You're like, "Hey, you know what? You just sound a bit off today. What's going on?" Like you can just feel, you have that intuition.
And it's that intuition and a whole lot more that Karl Cook is trying to teach the world about his sport.
You have a series on social media that you guys put out called Walking and Talking.
Yep,
so ironically, yep. Look at us. Huh? Ding,
gotta be walking and talking.
We have a 15-minute window where they're allowed to feed the hay. All right, so we're going to talk about lasers today. I used to poultice and wrapped. I don't care what you guys are saying that I'm never walking. I'm going to do some eventually while I'm walking.
What are you trying to accomplish with that, and how neat is it to connect with that community?
It's been great. It's been a great experience. It wasn't something I planned. It just kind of happened spontaneously. This world is kind of insular, and unless you're in it or, you know, you're paying a lot of money for a trainer, you don't really see a lot of this higher level stuff. You don't really learn it. And so I want to make a lot of this stuff more approachable, more understandable, and also show people where they can learn things that doesn't require, you know, a high-powered trainer or, you know, the greatest horse on the planet. There's so much more, and just assuming you can't is a cop-out.
There's one that touches the horse's back.
What isn't a cop-out is going from Olympic alternate to Olympic medalist.
You're a silver medalist, dude. I mean, has it sunk in yet?
I mean, you know, it was hard because you always think of, like, what would it feel like if you won a gold medal, or if you went to the Olympics, or if you won a silver medal, or whatever. Obviously, I had ideas of what I thought it would feel like. I don't know. What is it supposed to feel like? You know, it you know, I feel a lot of relief, you know, because it's very intense. It takes a lot of work, sacrifice, and effort. I feel a lot of relief and a lot of, you know, just calm confidence. Like, I feel like, okay, you know, that worked. It worked really well. So I'm on the right track, and, you know, I'm excited to keep going.